Okay, something I wanted to point out really quick. I originally designed this loop to operate on 15 and 17 meters as well as 20 and 40. The problem I ran into is 14 feet on the conductor length, the circumference, is too big. Remember from the previous snapshot, I'm using LMR 400 coax, 0.405 diameter. This is, I set this frequency for 15 meters. And the problem is, let me scroll down, check this out. Specified conductor length of 14 feet is not ideal. It's too long. The problem with this is, now you look at the efficiency, 91% efficient. Hey, that's great, right? It requires very little capacitance to tune. But if this, if the overall circumference of the secondary loop is too long, it'll function, it'll move out of the magnetic loop arena, it'll wave bye-bye, and it'll function more like a dummy load or a severely compromised dipole, which you don't want. You want to keep it in the E-field, operating in the E-field. So, bummer. 14 is too long. I'd have to go to, it says 11.2 feet, so probably an 11-foot loop. So what I can do is I can make an 11-foot loop. So let's change this to 11. See what it gives me. 82% efficient, approximately 30 puff to tune. And there we are. We're in the ballpark. With great efficiency, 0.9, not even 1 dB below 100%. So what you'd need to do if you want it for 15 and 17, this is what I would do. I would use an additional length, take an additional length of LMR 400, cut it to 11 feet, but remember you're going to have to make a new coupling loop as well. So the coupling loop would be 1/5 the size of this. So remember, multiply 11 times 0.2, and that'll give you the length of the coupling loop. Not a big deal. You just this is all built to be modular because of the narrow capacitance range I'm working with. All right, that being said, off and running. Okay, we're on to loop construction. I'm going to deal with the coupling loop first. Now, remember what we were talking about with the calculator. So, to get your, this is the coupling loop. This is the loop that connects to the coax. I did this out of, this is copper tubing, actually. I have a bunch of, a roll of this here. I like it because it's rigid and it holds its shape. There's a lot of speculation, which I don't think is speculation anymore. You notice that it's elliptical. What I try to do is I try to increase the coupling to the outer loops. This is the outer loop here. This is the part that connects to your coax. So this is like quarter inch tubing you can get in any big box store, hardware store, Home Depot's, Lowe's, you name it. They use it a lot in for ice makers, feeding an ice maker with water in a refrigerator. I like this stuff a lot, especially for the coupling loops. Now, let me show you what I got going on here. Remember, we were talking about resistance and loss and stuff like that. I'm trying to keep any hard connections to a minimum on everything. So the coax from the radio connects into this. This is just basically PVC end caps, and I use a lot of bulkhead connectors. And I have two wires, one off the center pin, one off the shield side of this SO239, comes into each end of the coupling loop right here. Drilled a couple holes. So you can do it however you want. You can use like a little electrical box or whatever. Now this, here's the catch with the coupling loop. If you run a two-turn loop, let's say it's modular like mine is, and you have a loop set up for 20 meters, and then you put an additional turn on it, turning it into a two-turn loop, you're going to need to move the feed point. You're going to need to move this coupling loop down a little bit or up, however you have your mag loop oriented, capacitor top or bottom. This goes on the opposite end. So what I did was I drilled a hole, and this slides onto the center support, which is half inch PVC. And I drilled a hole and I put a T-nut on it.
And what this does is it allows me to loosen it, and I can slide it basically up and down that pole. And I have it marked for where I need to put it for 40 meters, for the 40-meter band. 20 meters, you'll see it goes right up against the main loop. Gives me a flat SWR, provides maximum amount of coupling. The elliptical, you'll see a lot of people run round loops, but if you can increase the area here, your secondary loops run around like this. So if you can increase the amount of area here that will couple to the secondary loop, that's only going to be a benefit to you. You get more radiated power going out. I think that's pretty much proven at this point. So that's why this is a little elliptical. You see this. I wanted to go over that. Okay, that's a coupling loop. And you can even use coax, RG8X, RG50, whatever you want to use, even a piece of wire for the coupling loop. Now, I have 14 feet on the secondary loop, as you saw in the calculator. So your coupling loop needs to be 1/5 the size of the secondary loop. Okay, so just take your whatever your circumference is of your secondary loop, let's say 14 feet, multiply that times 0.2, and that'll give you the circumference for the coupling loop. Pretty easy, isn't it? Anyways, and it will work, I guarantee it. You don't want to go bigger than, I always go a little tiny bit shorter than 1/5. Okay, here's the catch. I wanted to eliminate any, like I was saying, any soft connections in the system. These are primary connections. So what I did was, you'll notice, if you remember from the box had the center pin and the shield basically connected together. I know some people don't connect the center pin if they're using a coax type connector, a 2.5, a UHF connector to connect their loops to. I do it. Connect the center pin. You want them shorted, because the center pin, if it's an open circuit in the middle of that, that's copper, and there may be some unwanted interaction there, degrading the performance. I don't know, but rule of thumb is connect the center pin to the shield. So that being said, I got the center pin soldered in here, and I left the braid. I didn't cut the braid, and I left it sticking out back here when I threaded the 259 on. And what I did was I used a soldering iron, and I went around this area with a soldering iron, and I soldered it right to the barrel of the 259. So that's a hard connection. That eliminates a possible poor connection. Now you still have the socket to deal with. So needless to say, make sure these are good and tight, and you'll be good to go. That covers the loops. Moving on. Okay, the support structure. This is basically half-inch PVC on a two-turn loop. This is a little noodly. You may not want to do this, and it's because the diameter is rather large. I'm using a 4-foot diameter loop instead of a 3 as the secondary loops. So, yeah, even though LMR, 14 feet of it is not that heavy, it's a fairly large loop. You may want to go to 3/4. I wanted this for ultra portability. I wanted to eliminate any excess weight. And 3/4 inch PVC. It's not that much bigger. I'll probably end up going to that. But you can pick up a PVC cross. This is called a cross for all the different tube diameters. And I basically made it all goes together. This part goes into the bottom, goes into the top of the box, into the lid of the box. And then what do we got here? Oops. And this part goes into the coupler, into the top of the cross. Into the top of the cross. Right there. That plugs in there. And then those two spreaders right there, they plug into each side. And the coax sits right in here. So let me drop this quick, and I'll show you what the coupling loop looks like on it. Okay, so this is what the coupling loop looks like on it. The coax runs right around here on the outside, and then around the circumference of the framework and down to the capacitor box. That's what it looks like. So it's movable. I can move it, shift it around. You may want to put on something. This is something I do. You really want to keep the coax out of the middle of the loop. So I drill a couple holes. I drill a hole through the center support, and I use a little fiberglass rod right here. And this provides support for the coax as it comes out of the 239. It comes up and out away from the center of the loop. Good idea to do that, especially if you're running some big power, you know, 100 watts or more. That's it for the loops. We'll be back.
Okay, that's what she looks like erected. I have it on an old light stand there. And you can see the coupling loop up there. It's basically the PVC framework socket on the little lid of the box. Half inch, punch a hole through, take a plug, thread it into the back side of that. You can mount the box. It's not required to have it up really high. I've seen a lot of people place them on the ground, but from everything I've read, they actually recommend putting the loop about one loop diameter, getting it up one loop diameter off the ground. So that's what I do. Seems to work really good. We'll be back with the testing. Coax feed line from the radio. Coax will jack in there. So that's basically it.
We'll be back. We'll go through a couple last things here. This is what's called an MFJ matchmaker. It's great for mag loop tuning. And I'll show you how to use that. This is the control box. On, off. Forward, reverse on the capacitor. So let's run through how to tune this sucker. They're on 14200. She's set up for 20 meters. And you go ahead and turn the matchmaker on. You can hear that. What you want to watch for is you want to see that S meter drop to S9. So we go ahead and we roll the capacitor. See that dip? That's pretty much tuned right there. See how it dropped to an S9? Close to an S9? There we go. She's bang on. I'll skip up to AM. We're on 50% drive. SWR, it's very difficult to do. I can do it quicker if I'm not looking through a cell phone. SWR, unreadable. That's what you want to see. Okay, so that's basically it in a nutshell. We'll catch you all later.